Richard Harrison grew up where in...
When I was born in Salt Lake City, Utah.
Really? You're a Utah boy. Same as Nan Robinson, matter of fact. She's from... Nan is from Utah.
You're kidding me.
Yes, you didn't know that?
No.
Yeah, tell me about growing up in Utah. Strict?
Well, I thought there was something wrong with me. I thought since I seemed to be the only person who thought like I did and that, and then when I came to California, I realized it was the rest of them that were wrong.
Uh-huh. But Robert Redford lives there. He loves it there.
God bless him.
He likes that environment. Tell me, actor, what age? What decided Richard Harrison to become an actor? At what age?
Well, when I was a little boy, I'd go to all the plays and everything. I went up by myself. And I always enjoyed it. I'd go to 2-3 films a day. Walked in free, naturally. Uh-huh. Snuck in. And then when I came out here, I got a job working in gyms. And everybody kept saying, you know, you should go to in Hollywood, you know, all the old BS. Uh-huh. And then somebody introduced me to Mike Conley.
Uh-huh.
And Mike told me definitely I should move out here and do that. And I was so naive.
Naive. I'm looking at you at young age from Utah.
Yeah, I was really naive.
You were a gym man like, what's his name? The German one?
Arnold.
Arnold Schwarzenegger, that type of body.
No. I never went in for heavy, but I believed in being symmetrical and that, and I did it, but I was. I never wanted to overdo it or anything.
Right.
I never did. But it brought me a living, and I liked it.
You did some modeling for briefs and stuff like that.
Yeah, right? And I did for my own, too. I had my own little car and my own little...
Really?
Made very good money at it. And, and I had my own little magazine and newsletters and everything.
Someone discovered you, or you just... how did it all happen first, Richard? First part?
Well, not really. I was so lost, I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't have the slightest idea about acting, and I got into a couple of acting coaches, and they...
Who were they, some of them?
At 20th was Sandy Meisner.
One of the best.
Sandy was very good.
Actor Studio.
I liked Sandy, and I got along very well with him, and I learned, you know, I learned from him, definitely. But, you know, what it was... The difference between acting in a studio and acting in cinema and theater and everything was so different. I mean, all of a sudden, you know, things that people did in the studio where they helped each other, all of a sudden I found myself in doing cinema and that nobody wanted to help anybody. I mean, it was every, you know, dog for himself.
A few years ago, I'm in Europe. I used to go to Europe a lot. And I'm in Europe, in Paris and London and Rome. Paris and Spain. Mm-hmm. In the theaters, outdoors, the theaters. Big, big, gigantic. Richard Harrison. It's the body, the gladiator body. You did those kind of movies for a while.
Yeah.
Big, all over Europe. Spain loves you. Italy loves you.
Yeah.
Those Latin places. How did you get involved in that?
Well, I went over there, and I was, first, as I said, I was under contract at 20th, and I was under contract at AIP.
Right.
And while I was there, I was offered a contract by a big producer, Zingarelli, and I went over there, and he put me in the Gladiator films. In fact, he told me to work out more because I wasn't, you know, as big as he wanted me to be, which I didn't want to be, larger. And, you know, that's a two-way street because... I worked a lot. I mean, I did 120 films as a lead. But at the same time, you get in a category you can't get out. And I wanted to do other films, but they only saw me as the leading man, you know, doing...
And spy things, too. A lot of spy movies.
Yeah, spy, westerns.
Westerns. Tell me about The Silver Dollar with Clint Eastwood and you. You had a battle between that.
Well, no, what happened is Pappy and Columbo, I'd done some western for them. And they asked me to do another Western, and they offered me less money, and it was more weeks, and they told me it was a bad script. I said, well, thank you. I said, you know, first of all, I don't want to do any more spaghetti Westerns, and then you offer me less money, then I finished 2 days before you for another film for more money, and you offer me less money and more weeks, and you say it's a bad film.
Uh-huh.
They said, well, you know, Leone wants you, Sergio Leone, and Sergio had only done one other film, as far as I know, and Sergio kept talking, and I said, I'm sorry, but... I, if you know, if there was a lot more money involved, I would do it. But so anyway, they finally they said, well, do you have any ideas? And they mentioned three names. And I said, well, at least Clint knows how to ride a horse because he did a TV series. Uh-huh. They said, all right. And they took Clint when Burt Reynolds and Clint Eastwood were there, I took them around, took them to parties, and introduced them to people. And, you know, and it was, I'm sorry.
Did you enjoy living in Rome?
Yeah, I'm very much.
Because you're very well loved there, and Spain and Rome and all those places.
Oh, I loved Spain. I adored, and Rome too. I mean, it was everything. Somebody mentioned we were talking about books and that, and they said, "Oh, why don't people write more books about it?" And I said, "Well, Fellini did. I mean, Fellini, mm-hmm. Dolce Vita says it all. I mean, who can say it better than that?"
Yes, exactly.
And it's true.
Do you know, I was there when they were doing that film with Anita Ekberg. I was living in Rome at the time. I think it was in that was in the 50s, late 50s, wasn't it? Or 50s?
Yeah, it was about probably 59, 60.
Yeah, around that, because I stayed there in that time, and I was there in the 60s too, early 60s. And I used to see your name around, Richard, later on, after. And that's how I'm very familiar with your name in Europe, but not in America. I wasn't too familiar, because I got confused. Richard Harrison and Richard Harris.
Right.
Very confusing. Because of that ISON a lot, you know?
Right.
Because you do look English.
Well, my father's English, and my relatives are all English.
You say IP. You married a lovely lady. Tell me about
daughter.
That.
Well, Loretta.
The daughter. You married the daughter.
Right. Loretta was 17 at the time. I was 24.
Uh-huh.
And I was doing a film called Master of the World, you know, with Vincent Price and Charles Bronson. In fact, Charles said, oh, look at that pretty girl.
You're very good friends, you two.
Oh, I liked, well, I haven't seen Charles for years, but he was on the set. We were very, got along very well, and then in Rome I saw him, and I liked him very much, always. And anyway, I married Loretta, and right away we left for Italy.
And how many children do you have from her?
I have three boys.
Three boys.
Right.
And the next sitting, one of them sitting with you.
Right.
A Sebastian. Wonderful actor, Sebastian. How are you?
The youngest.
You're the youngest, Sebastian? Yeah. Sebastian, you're an actor.
He started me out actually when I was about 3 years old in Italy in a film with Van Johnson.
Which one was that?
Oh, I don't know the title of it.
It was a takeoff on John Kennedy and his son, John John. He played John John.
Perfect. Yeah. Perfect, yeah.
But I fell asleep on the set, so I guess that was, you know, my first experience as an actor.
So you got the taste of it, right?
Tell you the truth, I don't remember it at all.
Okay.
I remember when, you know, from 15 on, I used to do commercials for a little bit of pocket money when I was living in Italy. Uh-huh. And then when I was, I guess, about 19 or 20, he had written a script for a director, I guess. Two stories, did you write?
Well, I know. Actually, I was going to produce it myself, and then I decided that Westerns were gone, so I sold it.
That was when they were making these new films with Silverado, and it was, you know, they were trying to make the remakes of all these Western films. And they asked my father if he knew an American or someone who speaks perfect English, blonde, etc. I used to be blonder. Uh-huh. And he said, well, I do, my son. And first they laughed. They said, yeah, sure. You know, and then I did the casting.
Uh-huh. Actually, they
did the casting.
They wanted the boy in Blue Lagoon.
You mean?
Was a very small budget film, and I don't think they understood exactly the economics of the project that they were undertaking.
Well, I said you were better anyway.
Is he better? Say?
He's a very good actor. He's very sure of himself, and
that's the important thing.
Unfortunately, he did
that film. That was my first real experience acting, I guess, besides doing commercials, which, you know, you have little cuts here, 3 second cuts, and doesn't, you know, take.
You're a big honk in Italy for the soap. You do with soaps, like the American soaps here. They have Italian soaps, don't they?
Yeah.
Tell me about the Italian soaps. I mean, is it different than here, or is it hotter, or what? Tell me.
The one I was doing was for younger kids, so it was not hotter whatsoever.
Really?
I mean, actually, the kissing was very, 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 we couldn't do it for more than, I think, 2 seconds or something like that. There are a lot of restrictions on how we could touch each other, kiss each other. So they're not hot at all.
Uh-huh.
Because they distributed these telefilms all over, you know, the world, and some countries have different laws regarding, you know, what you can do.
Have you been watching our American soaps? I mean, you haven't?
No, I don't like soap. I didn't even watch what I did. You know,
you didn't? You don't watch yourself in film?
I did the first about 50 episodes, and then
how many years? 2 years you were on it, or what?
2 years, 154 episodes. After it gets a little bit repetitious, so
Sebastian, same thing. Sitting there, it's like an experience. You're getting paid, and you're going to school, and you're learning, isn't it? In front of the camera, and I think isn't it great? I mean, it's
That was good. He did it in Italian, too.
For me, it was an acting experience.
Oh, parli italiano?
Sì.
Sì, I'd like...
Anche lei, bravo.
Sì, io parli poco. How many languages do you speak, Sebastian?
Two and a little bit of Spanish, two and a half.
See, your children are...
And a little bit of Norwegian, a little bit of Japanese. Right.
See, that's what's so good about you. You had your children, they traveled with you, and they...
Oh, yeah, they've been all over.
And how many others do you have?
Well, I have...
Three boys and one girl.
I have a little girl.
A little girl. Uh-huh. You just got married to you've been married, I think, 16 years?
15 years.
15 years to
Italian.
Francesca.
Right.
Tell me about Francesca.
She's a wonderful woman. She
How did you meet? How did you meet Francesca? I met her. She's lovely. She's beautiful. How did you meet her?
We met her. I was producing a film, and I was in doing the dubbing afterwards because you shoot without sound. And so we were doing the dubbing in Italian.
Uh-huh.
And she was there. She was working in a production for another company, and when we met at Fonaroma, and that's the place where you dub, and she was very shy. And then a few months later, we met again at Technicolor, and then a young director wanted to come over and bring over several people to my home.
Uh-huh.
I remember I said no, because I really didn't want to see anybody that evening. And he insisted, and he brought her over, and Francesca was part of the group. And from that time on, we were together, and we got married after 1 month.
Really? That's great.
Yeah.
What's happening with your career now? You're back in America, and Sebastian, you're with your dad here. What's happening with you? Are you...
Well, I haven't really been pursuing it that much.
Uh-huh.
Because I've been, you know, between school and work and traveling around. I was in Japan.
You're going to school right now, are you?
I'm taking some class at UCLA.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Father writes. Are you going to be a writer also, or are you writing?
No, I don't think so.
You write all your scripts, do you?
Most of them, yes.
And you like to direct?
Well, I'll tell you that when I did the directing, the films were so short, and I was shooting maybe over 100 setups in a day, and you wouldn't really call that directing. You'd call it getting a film made. You know.
Some of the films, you've done so many, what are some of the favorites of Richard Harrison's films that you enjoy doing, some of them?
Well, let me just say that probably the first film that I ever wrote, directed, and produced, and we did the costumes and everything, I really put a lot of energy into it. It was a Western, comic Western, and it's on tape here. It's called Jesse and Lester, Two Brothers in a Place Called Trinity. Uh-huh. It's interesting because I split myself down the middle, and I made my half-brother, he wanted to build a whorehouse. Oh, no, I want to build a whorehouse, and he wants to build a church.
Uh-huh.
And I keep telling him, you know, we can always interchange our customers and that. And it was rather cute, and it did quite well.
Uh-huh. Got good, that was one of my favorite films.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is that one of your favorites of your dad's films?
I enjoy them all because he always plays, you know, you look up to him being the son, he plays the hero, either the gladiator, shooting people, always the hero against the woman, you know.
Some of the leading ladies you've worked with gorgeous European ladies, international beauties like Sophia Loren. I mean, that type of quality ladies.
Well, I worked with Anita Ekberg. Anita, she was sweet.
Anita Ekberg, yes.
She was very sweet. It was amazing.
She really?
Oh, she's like a little baby. She's so sweet. Michelle Mercier was probably one of the most beautiful. Michelle did
What film did you do with Anita Ekberg? Do you remember?
It was called The...
Doesn't matter.
Longest Day... you know, I have to translate from Italian. It was Lungo...
Parli italiano, sì.
No, I lost all my Lungo Giorno di Cavalcato. Longest Day of Galloping or something like that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's a very bad translation.
Right.
Longest Day of...
I'm sure they changed the title here anyway.
Right. You've done a lot of European films, though, with different languages in.
Right.
Dubbing.
Sometimes in one scene, there'd be five languages.
Really?
And it's funny, though. It never bothered me, because if an actor, you know, knew what he was doing, you fell right into it, and you pick up enough. Like when I was in Turkey, I could speak enough Turkish so that I could communicate with the people. And when I was in Taiwan, I learned enough Chinese to communicate.
Uh-huh.
And unfortunately, when you leave, you know, you don't speak the language anymore, and you forget every word. Mm-hmm. Like, he learned enough Japanese to at least communicate, didn't you?
I was getting by, but, you know, after not speaking,
you forget.
Richard Harrison, favorite place in the world. I've traveled like you have, but not as much, I don't think. Favorite place in the whole world.
Oh, let me tell you.
There's a dangerous world out there. What is your favorite?
No, one thing I found out, it has nothing to do with the place. It has to do with the people. if you have a good friend, any place is beautiful. You can be in the most beautiful place in the world, and you, if you don't have a friend there, you don't have the right people, you hate it.
That's what it is. It's friends.
Anyway. Yeah, that's the friendship that's more important than the place.
Taiwan. I worked Taiwan. I love Taiwan.
Did you?
Yeah, I worked Taipei. I was in military shows. I did those military shows. You dance, you sing, Sebastian? Because you have long legs. You do dance, do you? You do musicals?
To club feet. No, the TV series that I was doing, actually we were musicians, but it was all in, they call it playback, all dubbed.
Have you done any plays since you've been here? Any live theater? That's
No,
so
I've
important.
Never done live theater ever. I just, you know, when I went to acting school, we'd do little part, little scenes, but an entire play, I've never done that. Besides Jesus Christ. You know, when I played Jesus Christ when I was about 2 or 3.
Actually, he was offered in Italian, big theater, and he didn't do it, and I was sorry about that because they wanted him to do it.
Susan Strasberg teaches in Rome right now. She's there all the time.
Susan's
she teaches.
There?
Yeah, she constantly teaches. They love her. She's going to move to Rome. She adores Rome. Michael Douglas is leaving for Switzerland, and Susan's leaving for Italy. Everyone's leaving America, you know. Richard Harrison lives in Malibu. I mean, are you going to stay in Malibu, or are you just...
Yes, no, it's
you
the
like
only
it?
Place. Absolutely.
Is it really?
Like it.
Why is it?
Well, we have, number one, we have 3 1/3 acres on PCH, and we have our own little world there. We have a tremendous amount of international friends, and, you know, it's our own little world there.
Yeah, Burgess Meredith loves it, too. Burgess is...
Unless it rains too much.
You have problems there, right.
He had a lot of problems.
So, Richard Harrison, you go back, travel all over the world. You stay in in Rome a lot, do you?
We were supposed to leave Friday for Rome, but we just
doing another film,
out.
Are you? Or?
No, we were just going there to just go down the islands in Sicily and enjoy ourselves.
What's your philosophy of life?
Well,
you seem kind of...
To enjoy it.
To enjoy. You seem like that. Your dad is he easy to get along with? He seems like a...
He is, as long as you you don't take advantage of him or... As long as you abide by his rules, let's put it that way. He, you know, I mean, he's lived a full life, and he definitely wants his tranquility. And if you try to change, you know, the way his approach of life is, then he won't agree with you, and you won't get along with him.
What have you learned from your dad?
I've learned a lot. You know, growing up with him, he's passed on, I guess, a lot of his philosophy and a lot of his. Of what he's learned. He's had to do everything pretty much by himself because, you know, when he was 18, he came to Los Angeles and he learned everything basically by himself without having anyone to teach him. Mm-hmm. And he's tried to pass on every experience to me. He gives me a lot of guidance even right now. Even though I'm 27, he gives me a lot of guidance.
Uh-huh. So you're a tight family, the children. You're very close to your family.
Well, you know, I have to say that naturally you love all your sons.
Right.
Sebastian, maybe because he's been with me more always because the other two boys came back to Los Angeles.
And what do they do, the other two?
One has his own business in electrician, and the other one goes to school. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But Sebastian has been very close, and we're always together. And I feel good with him because he also has a very European way about him.
Uh-huh. And a little bit more compatible.
He does, very European. Right. You like that?
Yeah,
I think it rubbed. I think it's your attitude. It all rubbed against the children, didn't it?
Well, I think so. You know, you have to understand that I feel maybe a little more Italian or
than American. American. Yes. I'm talking to you. I feel.
Yes.
I feel that.
And
your mentality.
Sebastian
your mentality is. I can see it.
Yes, I feel
very European.
If I run into some Italian friends or men, I feel at home. I feel very good.
Because you spent most of your real life, growing up in life.
Right.
Away.
It was a great school.
It was, wasn't it, Richard?
And Spain, you know, Spain.
Tell me about
too.
Spain.
Spain, I went there in 1961. I built a beautiful place in Marbella, Spain, on the beach.
Right.
I had a nice place in Madrid. And it was under Franco. And for us, I mean, for the foreigner, I can't speak for the Spanish, but for the foreigner, it was great in a sense there was no such thing as crime, you know.
Uh-huh.
I left my home completely open. I left the convertible. I had a little 190 Mercedes convertible. I left it open. Mm-hmm. I don't know. If I had a flat tire, the policeman would come over and want to change it for me. Uh-huh. You could eat a meal for 25 cents. I mean, you'd go in and you'd buy 20 silk shirts, you know, for nothing, and our suits. And I mean, it was. I spent my time at a bullfight. I remember especially with Gilbert Roland when we did a film together. We both loved
bullfight. What kind of guy was Gilbert Roland? I loved him. What kind of guy was he?
Fantastic.
He loved life, didn't he?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I haven't seen him because I called him not too long ago and his phone has been changed. He loves life and he loves women, naturally, very much so. And I liked him because he's a real macho, you know.
So you grew up, Richard Harrison grew up with the machos like Clint Eastwood and all those guys back in the 50s and the 60s. And when Rome was Rome, Via Veneto, what life.
Great.
Sebastian, it was great then. I mean, you're a little boy.
So I hear.
Oh.
I don't remember it.
Richard, I mean, an American
fantastic.
In Paris or American in Rome or Spain,
it was beautiful.
Right.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Am I right? It's changed, am I right, Richard?
It's changed. Unfortunately, it's changed. Even the people don't even dress as well, and they're not as happy.
You
as
like to dress, don't you? Of course.
Yes, I do.
Like to put a jacket on. And
I have so many suits and tuxedos sitting there just not being used.
Uh-huh.
Because a lot of people actually ask me, they said, please don't wear a tie. They actually said, please don't wear a tie.
Right.
Because I'd always wear a suit like in Rome and a tie.
Yes.
And a lot of people don't, you know, they feel uncomfortable with you. Uh-huh. So I don't, but I miss that very much.
Sebastian, what's going to happen with you now here in Hollywood? I mean, we got to get you some work.
Good question.
You know, this guy is a good-looking guy.
And he's a good actor.
He is
really
he?
Is. He's a very
You ride horses and all that? Like
yeah, actually, the first film that I did, I was telling you, it was a Western.
Uh-huh.
You know.
So you do ride.
Oh, he rides very well. He can jump from one horse to the other and do all that.
Uh-huh.
All the things I told him not to do.
Did you know Cornell Wilde, did you?
I didn't, but I always wanted to, and I always liked the man very
I interviewed
much.
Him last. He was wonderful. He was a great guy. Yeah. And I interviewed his son. It reminds me of Cornell Wilde Jr.
I never knew his son.
Yeah, he has a Cornell Wilde Jr. Are you writing a book about an American who went to Europe and conquered those films? 100 and something.
No,
Richard Harrison.
Everybody keeps talking about doing things like that.
Come on.
I don't know. I just...
You're interesting. Interesting.
What, should I tell the truth?
Well, what's life all about if you don't tell the
truth? Can you tell the truth nowadays?
Yes.
Can you now?
Ask Jaja.
I'll ask Linda.
Oh, Linda Christian. Tell me about Linda Christian. You and her are very close.
Very good friends.
It's Tyrone Power's ex-wife.
Yeah, she's going to bring her first book to me Saturday, because I haven't read it. She wrote several years ago. She's writing another one now, but she says it's very hard for her because she doesn't want to go in the past, and she likes to only think of the future.
I interviewed her. That's exactly what she didn't want to do.
Yeah.
I asked her, and she doesn't want to go into the future. Why?
Well, I think
it's fun to go
to
into
a point. I think when you're just talking like that, it is. But otherwise, you know, it's...
So Richard Harrison doesn't like to go into the past so much.
I like to be with people because I have to tell you, I was very, very lucky because before I went to Italy, I got here in time to know a lot of wonderful people, the Cucors and people like that.
Charles, of course.
Who I adored. I adored George. And people like that who were so elegant, and I call them the prince.
They don't have that anymore.
But they were the royalty.
Yes.
And I mean, they really were wonderful, gorgeous people, you know, in every way. Mm-hmm. I remember a Cucor told me once, he said, you know, Richard, he told me, he says, you know, don't waste time with what you're not. You know, he once told me, he said, you know, when I came here being Jewish and small and that, he said, it was all against me at the time. And he said, and I thought I was an ugly little man. And I said, George, I said, I think you're a beautiful man.
Yes, he is.
I thought he was beautiful. Mm-hmm. But I mean, it shows you that I think you become beautiful. And he was, I found him a very beautiful man.
Yes, he was elegant,
too. Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
And it's just such a nice man.
That's what Hollywood's missing today, or the country, America especially. Elegance. They don't have style. The word is style. Everyone wears their baseball caps backwards, they look alike, and there is no style. Individuality.
And they don't
style.
Want it. They don't want it. They
Why
don't
is even, that, Richard?
I don't know. They don't even want to speak English
You're
correctly.
Young. Tell me, what's happening?
Don't ask me. Most of my friends are Italian.
Oh, so they dress. They dress with ascots and stuff like that. Yes.
Well, American culture is what it is, basically. I mean, they take little bits and pieces of different cultures and try to improve or worsen it. You know, half the time. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I've never really followed American mode of dressing or culture that much as it is. You know,
because
I do my
you follow
own
your own dressing.
Pretty much.
That's
a little. You know, in Italy, maybe I wouldn't have even
learned
this. In Italy, you know, you have to adapt a little bit to a certain degree, but
Richard Harrison, looking back over your career, any regrets? Not coming back to, I mean, leaving America or just staying there or, coming, what do you think?
A fistful of dollars would have been nice.
Would you do it the same way?
Oh, no, never.
Would you do it the same way?
Oh, no, I would do things very differently. I think that, my God, otherwise it means you haven't learned anything in life.
Uh-huh.
Oh, I would study 10 times more than I did.
What have you learned in life, Richard Harrison?
Well, I spend most of my time reading books. And the more you learn, the more life is beautiful. I mean, it's fantastic. I mean, every time you learn a little bit more, it just makes life that much better. And so, I would have started from day one to learn, just to keep learning and studying.
Shelley Winters said, to be a good actor, you got to read a lot, and listen. And that's what she said. Is that the secret of acting?
Well,
one of the secrets, anyway.
I mean, it's just
people don't read.
Yeah, but I don't. You mentioned one woman. I think she's just a natural actress. I don't think it has anything to
do with
that.
Is there a word as natural?
Well, I think she is. I know she's studied hard and
everything. Right, right,
right. But I think of all the people, you just happen to mention somebody who I think is really a natural actress.
Kim Stanley, another one. Well,
yeah, I think, but she,
these
I think,
are
but she
actresses.
Seemed more of a studied, I mean, somebody who studied.
Shelley is natural, yeah. I see what you mean.
Don't you get that?
Yeah,
she's really from the earth.
Yeah.
Because she did some things in Italy, and I have to say.
Have you ever worked with her in the film?
No, I haven't. No, I haven't.
Uh-huh.
No.
Who's some of the great ladies you like to work with, some of the older ladies, actresses, that you enjoyed working with?
Oh, I mean, there's so many wonderful actresses out there. I mean, every one of them. There's so many beautiful people, and I'm sorry a lot of them aren't working, because there aren't parts for them. But
the American films are all going everywhere. Canada, they're not Hollywood is not Hollywood like it used to be. Hollywood is television now.
Yes.
And Hollywood is not the capital of movies anymore. I think they're all over the world. Even the Missouri is Hollywood now.
Oh, yeah.
Is that right?
Absolutely. Well, it seems to me that they don't take care of the people enough here. I mean, if you want to even shoot in the street, they want so much money and so many permits, and it's so difficult to shoot here. I mean, it's still convenient because you can get the movies, the lights, and be missing a part, or you need something, it's good. But otherwise, I don't think they're that good to the people here. Uh-huh. I mean, everybody's out to get their, some money. Uh-huh. I think if they want to bring people back here, they've got to be a little bit more generous. Uh-huh. And I guess that's more than just movies.
Sebastian, you're going to go back to Rome, are you? You are, aren't you? You're going back to Europe, too.
I love Rome and I love Europe.
Uh-huh.
Hello, Skip Lowe.
Greek father, or French mother?
Greek father, born in Greece.
Really? You were born in Greece?
No, father born in Greece.
Yes.
mother of French-English descent, born in Palo Alto, California.
Ah, but grew up in San Jose.
Grew up in
San Jose. Tell me about growing up
in San Jose. How does that make sense?
No, it's good.
Actually, my mother and father met in San Francisco. When he came from Greece, he was like maybe 18 or 19 years old.
Uh-huh.
On one of these fishing boats. And my mother was a candy dipper, she and her sister.
Uh-huh.
And they met in San Francisco, and I think they married 6 months after they were courting.
Uh-huh.
And my dad, being a barber and a great cook, good chef, Greek cooking, decided to move to Palo Alto.
Uh-huh.
And my mother's mother had been born also in Palo Alto. So
right.
It was a little town outside of Palo Alto called Mayfield.
Uh-huh.
And we lived there for a few years. And
mm-hmm.
then we later moved on to San Jose, mm-hmm. which was the place he wanted to go because he wanted to open a Greek restaurant.
Uh-huh. Singing, come on, that beautiful voice of yours. At
well,
what age?
Singing, oh.
Come on, 12?
I should have brought a couple of pictures. I just remember because you're so good with the going back into nostalgia. About 12 years old, actually.
Uh-huh.
When I decided, singing with records, you know, there was K-Star, Doris Day,
hey,
and I would
right.
mimic all these singers, and uh-huh. my father having a restaurant, I'd work with the jukebox and add all the records.
Uh-huh.
So I wasn't too shy. When it came up to singing or performing, actually I was more comfortable than just talking uh-huh. or entertaining uh-huh. the people, just uh-huh. being Fran. So that, I felt very comfortable doing that. So I won, it was Del Courtney's Amateur Hour in San Jose.
Everybody has to start somewhere.
And it was that, and uh-huh. I think I did a song. I got in drag, actually. I did the short skirt, heels, and the whole bit. My sister-in-law's would get up. And I did a song called What Did I Do, which was a Betty Grable song from a
yes,
film.
Yes, that's right.
And I won a Bulova watch, and I won some groceries, and I won
uh-huh.
some records, and I was on my way. I thought, this is what I love to do. And
uh-huh.
I loved the applause, and I love that feeling of getting all dressed up and,
right.
wow, I can
right.
do it.
Uh-huh.
And that's where it started, actually.
Then... band singer after? Did you become
no,
a band?
Everybody
no.
thinks that. I was a little too young.
You were, didn't you?
You know, it was Fran Warren and
yeah.
all the
yeah.
others. I know, because I work with Fran, and she's, oh, my dear, you're such a child. I said, thank you. no, I actually, the band, I didn't start bands. It was trios.
Trios.
So I went to San Francisco. I auditioned at a place called Ann's 440, which
of
was
course.
Like a wonderful,
wonderful
workshop.
Room. Oh, of course.
Wonderful workshop where
yeah.
everybody got a chance to do what they do.
Like
Johnny
the Bolshoi
Mathis
in New York and, it used to be.
Yeah.
yeah, exactly.
So I worked there for about... I guess 3 months to get good experience, and she was a wonderful coach. And I met Charles Pierce there, I met Lenny Bruce
uh-huh.
there, I met Johnny Mathis, it was wonderful. Then in comes Bob Scobie, who had the Dixieland Band,
right.
who was going to Las Vegas,
right.
the Flamingo. I was then 17, I was working weekends, my father
uh-huh.
let me go up.
Uh-huh.
And he said, I just love your energy, and I love your and I love your tunes. He said,
uh-huh.
Would you like, I said, well, I don't sing Dixieland. He said, my dear, sing what you have, come up and join me. And I did. I joined him for like 2 months in Las Vegas.
Uh-huh.
And I took my mom with me because my father wouldn't like me to go
at
alone.
17
at 17
in Las Vegas,
yes.
Nevada,
and
then.
And it was the hot spot then. So it was a wonderful experience to sing with a Dixieland group. But I did wonderful tunes like I'm the Lonesomest Gal in Town.
Right.
And I did Them Their Eyes. I fell in love with you first time I looked into.
Uh-huh.
And he said, you have wonderful time, little girl. And I said, thank you very much.
Uh-huh.
And he said, that's something that within you.
It is actually
yeah.
within.
And I think
yeah.
then I went back to San Francisco. There was a place called Fax 2, which was like a jazz club.
Yeah.
Fax 2,
uh-huh.
do you remember that? And George Andrews, a Greek, owned it, who was a fan of mine. And also, he said, I have a Dick Hames coming in. He's making a comeback. Would you like to come in? Because people know you in town. And I think the package would be great. I said,
right.
Dick Hames, the guy that does
he
the
gonna
movies.
He was going to come in to sing.
Coming
yeah.
in to sing.
Right.
And we'll introduce Fran Jeffries, hometown
then,
girl,
mm-hmm.
and Dick Hames. And I said, oh, interesting. Well, unbeknownst to me that the man was so powerful as far as films and what have you, but he had so much problems at that point.
Did he have problems?
Divorce
yeah,
from Rita Hayworth
right.
and the bad press. But the voice was wonderful,
uh-huh.
and the women were there, flocked to see him. So we were there for 2-3 weeks. We were held over for 2 months.
Uh-huh.
We did such business. And
but the 2 months.
The 2 months.
You got to know Dick Hames. Come on,
and
Fran.
I was still a child, you know.
You got to know Mr. Dick Hames.
I think Dick Hames was then maybe in his 40s, early 40s,
uh-huh.
and I'm still a baby. And my
fell in love?
Yes, we
right.
did. I did fall in love with him. He was
you
so
did?
Yeah, he
what
was
made,
so
what,
charming.
What do you, it was charm?
He was charming. He was... Well, he was such a worldly man. He spoke
uh-huh.
three or four languages, and he'd had all these gorgeous wives, you know, and I thought, right. My God, but I can't compete with him. I'm a little girl from San Jose, but I was very sophisticated and shy, and he liked that about me. Uh-huh. And we had dinner a couple of times, and he met my dad. My dad really liked him. He thought he was just a super charming guy. He just said, I hope he doesn't have all the problems they write about.
Right.
You know, I said, well, get to meet him and see the man for himself, what he's like. And we did. I did fall in love with him. And
Did he propose right away?
I think it was, I was very shy at that point, and I think he knew that that wasn't the right thing to do. So he said, you know, I have a couple of places that I have booked to work in Hawaii, and I have a place in Phoenix, and I'd love for you to join me. Because the reaction with the crowds were, oh, you two should sing together,
right.
Do a duet or something, because you just have a wonderful, something charisma
Flair,
going there.
Of course, great.
Which we did. I mean, it was exciting. I mean, he was the great ballad singer, and here I could sing ballads, but I was more swing, and I had this wonderful time, which he loved about me. So the combination, he thought, would be wonderful. So we worked two or three spots before he proposed, you know, and it was like, I said, well, I'll have to ask my parents, which I did, and they, of course, they adored him, you know. And it was magical. It was wonderful. Because I really did, I fell, you know.
You fell in love.
I fell in love at a very young age.
You guys worked together for long.
We worked together for about 3.5, 4 years.
Yeah, you worked all over. And also.
And I had Stephanie, my daughter, like
you
quickly.
Had a daughter,
you know,
right.
Stephanie Haynes.
Right away.
I didn't know about what to do those days, you know.
Tell me.
And I didn't know he had 4 or 5 other children.
You didn't?
Not really.
No, I see.
We didn't even talk about that.
What did you talk about, you guys?
Mostly about Europe. I was fascinated because I hadn't been to Europe. And all the stories from my father being born in Greece, I wanted to go to Greece. And then he had been to the Greek islands, and he'd also been to... He was schooled in Switzerland, so he spoke beautiful French, and I was fascinated by his lifestyle, you know, and all the beautiful ladies he was married to. So it was like I grew up very fast with him. Within 2 years, I learned not to speak so much as I do now. I was very shy because everybody said, "Gee, does she talk? Does she say anything?" You know, because he was like the teacher, and I would learn from him, and he'd say, "You have to listen and then speak."
Did he ever talk to you, tell you things about his wife, Rita Hayworth, and all these things?
Oh, yes.
Do you used to talk about
that? Oh, yes.
Did he really?
I wanted to know. I later met Rita, and I really liked her.
You wanted to know.
She was a fabulous lady. Yes, and the interesting thing about Rita Hayworth was that all this gorgeous sex and beauty and charm, the sex symbol, he said, she wasn't that way at all, really. You know, let's talk about the person, like I'm not that way. I'm on stage, more sexual person. But she basically was a very shy lady. And I guess that's why they both got into the alcohol, whatever, to make them more relaxed around people.
Did he drink a lot when he was around you?
Oh, he had a terrible problem, Skippy. Yeah, and
Did you try to do something, Fran?
You know, in those days, I was hoping, I said, gee, it would be wonderful if we had all the clinics and all the things today that we have all the help.
Right.
It wasn't mentioned that much at that time.
No,
you know,
it was
always kind of like pushed aside.
Yeah,
and it wasn't like the worst thing you could do. Mm-hmm. But like you said, in the 30s and the 40s, it was booze and broads and films and everybody
hung out
and drank.
From the time he got up in the morning, did you start drinking?
In the beginning of our relationship, no. Because he was trying to cool it. You know, he wasn't trying to...
Yes.
He was really trying because the relationship was very important to him, he and I. But that happened about 3 years later, I couldn't handle that because I didn't know about that. I didn't come from a family
of
alcoholics or anything like that. But it was a problem, and I was offered to do a film, The Pink Panther, to sing the song because we'd done a benefit for Blake Edwards, and he said, I want Fran to do the film, and it's not really
film.
A part, I want her to introduce a song written by Mancini, so it was called The Pink Panther.
Pink Panther, and it was great.
I did it in Italian called Meglio Stasera, and he joined me. He didn't want to work without me at that point, and I said, go do Summer Stock, because you're so wonderful. Go do Guys and Dolls, do other things.
I used to see him in England a lot, you know, in Manchester, Leeds. He worked all those places around that area.
He did.
I remember.
So he joined me in, we were in Rome for 3 months, and that wasn't a great time because he wasn't working. He was very, very insecure at that point.
Yes.
And I was glad to have him there, but yet it wasn't working out. So I just said, you know, you should wait, go back and do some theater, get involved, and I'll join you, you know.
Yes.
So that became a problem when I was offered to do this show and that show. As you know, there were so many variety shows, and he didn't want to work without me.
Yeah.
which also had to do with this Svengali thing he had with me. You know, Fran sing this and Fran wear this. And
did he really do
I
that?
I did, because he had wonderful, wonderful taste. The same thing when I talked to Abby Lane. You know, she had the same thing
same
with Kukot,
with
you
Kukot.
Know.
Yeah.
And she was even younger than I. Uh-huh. So you have to figure, I married Hames like 20. Stephanie,
did he really tell you what he liked to
oh,
wear?
Oh, and he had wonderful taste.
Yes.
But so it was wonderful taste, uh-huh. So I went,
so he really showed you life, didn't
he? He sure did. He did teach me. He was a wonderful teacher in music as far as picking
your
great
songs,
great ballads, and he knew what was good for me at that time.
So when I'm seeing Fran Jeffries today on stage, like the Roosevelt, I just saw you at the Roosevelt.
Right.
That's a little Dick Hames' taste there, is that correct?
I'd say a little bit of the taste, because I think what I do now is very tasty and beautiful
yes.
songs.
Yes, beautiful.
And that's the way I want to continue my song.
Ed Sullivan Show.
Yeah.
Guys, tell me about the Ed Sullivan Show.
Well, he adored us. We did a lot of shows in New York City. At the time, you know, in the 60s, there was the Waldorf Astoria, there was the Copacabana,
God,
there was
you guys
the Plaza.
Were big hits all these places.
We were like the Stephen Eady at that time, right?
Yeah, you were.
And even more glamorous, because Dick would wear these gorgeous suits and velvet jackets and vests and watch fobs. I mean, he was just very elegant. Uh-huh. As you can see, I still admire the man. And I had a wonderful couturier that was a Greek boy, Duca, and he made these gorgeous gowns. Uh-huh. I mean, magnificent. And we opened at the Waldorf Astoria in 63, I think it was. It was snowing. It was a wonderful turnout. I mean, Lucille Ball was there, Jack Benny. I mean, all the celebrities came
in.
It was always a wonderful opening to see him. Uh-huh. And he was doing well then. He wasn't drinking. He was really on his good behavior. We had a wonderful show written by Peter Matz, who writes all the arrangements.
Oh, yes.
Dick Williams was Andy's brother. He wrote all the special material. As you'll hear in the clip, somebody sent me this clip. We did about four or five Ed Sullivan shows. Uh-huh. I did some without him, which he
but
didn't
this
like.
One I
and we did the duet, which was wonderful.
I love to see this.
It's
matter
great.
Of fact, they're showing this now. They're re-showing all the Ed Sullivan
yes,
things.
Yes, and I think one of the producers that came into uh-huh. my daughter's restaurant brought me this tape. He said, I think you'll enjoy
good.
This to see. And I watched it. I said, am I going to like this? And I thought, you know what? It's wonderful.
Let the audience see it.
Yeah, I think it's great.
Let's go back to the Ed Sullivan days.
Great.
With Fran Jeffries and Dick Hames.
Here in a particularly lovely gown is Fran Jeffries, and with her, of course, Dick Hames. So, that's it.
Where's that man who calls me Mrs. Hames? Is he playing games? Where's that man who left me in a rage, waiting on the stage?
Never fear, my dear, I'm right here. And I'll never leave you in a rage, waiting on the stage. It will never happen again. 'Cause, ooh, some people may say we do some crazy thing.
Hey, but who's somebody to say that we're not a wonderful twosome? A funny, even without much money.
We'll live in heaven, honey. Two for the price of one.
Just
by sticking together, suburban little bungalows out in the sticks.
Might be lots of fun to go out and pick.
Pick a peck of pennies,
all we can. We can use it on a loan installment plan.
Suppose we don't find the future rosy.
Still we'll be coupled.
'Cause of the love we share, hand in glove, what a love, what is there left to say, except if we think that love is here to stay, is here to stay.
And I mean to kiss me a few. Oh, those guys don't know what they're missing. I've got those pretty cars, all shiny and new. I've got to move, 'cause time is a-wasting, and there's such a lot of living to do.
Jeffries, Dick Haynes. I mean, he sings forever.
What a life.
He loves to sing on stage, doesn't he? All the time. Dick
sings. Gorgeous singer, yeah. I loved his voice. I mean, that baritone, to me, he was just even a better sound than Sinatra.
My favorite song.
But Sinatra could swing better than Dick.
You know,
Dick always said that, yeah, he was like always with the tempo thing. But Haynes chose beautiful ballads, The More I See You and The Very Thought of You. And he had that gorgeous speaking voice. When you'd hear him speak, you would melt. I mean,
State Fair, what a great picture that was.
State Fair.
What was that song, Springtime? That's a great song.
I'm as restless as a willow. I do it in the show.
You do?
I do it as a samba.
Yeah.
It might as well be spring.
You had a great time at the Roosevelt.
I love that room.
And you're going back.
At the Center Grill, you know, that's one of the nicest rooms in town. I mean, there are no more nice rooms like that.
Right.
And Dick Drew, who was, I think, managing one of the Fairmont hotels when I worked there a while back, asked if I'd like to come in. And unfortunately, it was Memorial Day weekend, but I'm going to go back probably end of September, October. For 3 days. I did five nights when you saw me. But it's such an elegant, classy room. And I had the best musicians, the best trio. They were wonderful.
You had some great people come to see you that night, too.
It was great. It was great fun. And,
Fran, I was in Vietnam, too. And you were there with the Bob Hope show, though. Tell me about the Bob Hope show.
The last Christmas show, which was what,
1972? 72.
We went with, I think it was Red Fox, Lola Falana. Roman Gabriel, one of the ball players, and all the beautiful girls. And I loved the show because we got to do a duet together, he and I. It was wonderful.
Right.
And we went to Alaska the first show, and then we ended up in Bangkok for like 2 weeks, and Dolores Hope was with us.
Right.
And,
she sings great.
Oh, she's wonderful. She always did a song on the show.
Did she?
White Christmas, and I do Silent Night. Fabulous lady. And it was quite an experience. You know, we were we went to the Indian Ocean. I mean, some of the places that I hear about, I mean, I've never been. You know, I still have shells I collected from them. We did shows for the boys. Sometimes we couldn't leave that day or that night. We'd have to stay over, and they were crying, and they were so sad, you know, for the fact that we were leaving.
Right.
And it was quite an experience, and it was wonderful working with the band, you know, and 50 great people we traveled together for.
Bob Hope is great, though.
He's a wonderful man.
Yeah.
Oh, he's special. Special.
Looking back.
Yes.
What has been the hardest for you? I know you have a lovely daughter from Dick Haynes.
The greatest,
Her name is Stephanie Haynes.
She's
beautiful.
Very smart businesswoman.
And I'm going to show you. You guys were just on Beverly Hills 213. Look,
yeah, that's great, with my two beautiful granddaughters.
There we are. There's Stephanie.
And Stephanie's
that's
very
you
successful.
And your two granddaughters.
She's a wonderful businesswoman.
Uh-huh.
And
beautiful.
She owns a great restaurant called Cicada.
She has a restaurant.
A great restaurant called Cicada,
uh-huh,
which is on Melrose and La Cienega.
Right.
And her partner is Bernie Taupin.
Is that the Taupin?
The writer.
Writer.
With Elton John.
John.
Uh-huh. And Jean-Francois Metanier, who is a wonderful chef who was at Lingerie for a while.
Right.
So they got together about a year ago, and it's been very successful.
Where's the restaurant? On La Cienega in
8478.
Is it right on Melrose?
Yes, it's right at that peak. It used to be the old Sonny Bono restaurant.
Oh, is that?
Yes, the pasta place.
How long has she had that?
It's a year February. A year
oh, really?
And a half ago, sure.
And Grace Robbins used to sing there.
Grace Robbins used to go
you
in
sing
there. When
and
it was,
sing.
Yes, she
when
did.
When it was called something else.
Was
that the room?
It was Caruso's.
Caruso's,
or like
that's
that.
It.
We thought of putting a piano bar in
why
there, but
don't
I
you?
Don't know if I would do that there. I'm so particular about sound and
right.
my trio.
Right.
I think I'll save it for the Santa Grill.
I think you're
because
right.
Because Cicada's really a place to come and great lunch
uh-huh.
and dine. And, you know, I don't think that you want to go in the bar and hear music. Uh-huh. I don't think that's the kind of
place. What have been some of the happiest memories for Fran Jeffrey? Because you've done so many clubs and theaters and
I think,
traveled around the world. And
well, working-wise, and I think I always say this in my act at the end of the show, I had the opportunity of working with Dick Shawn when I was very young in Chicago. Then in 82, I was asked to do a wonderful book show with him called The Great American Dream, which he partially wrote. And he also was a good director. So we did that for 3 months
uh-huh.
in Lake Tahoe. And it was so, so wonderful. And at that time, he was talking about doing his one-man show. And, you know, this is something he really wanted, which was horrible.
Horrible.
I was there when I went to see it. A horrible accident that happened to him.
But, were you there that night it happened?
Yes. Yeah. And I loved him so much. And he used to pace my show. And I had the best time. The other outstanding time in my life was working with Sammy Davis when we toured Europe
uh-huh.
in 67.
Uh-huh.
With Augie and Margot, the dance team,
right,
and
great.
Sammy Davis and a 30-piece orchestra. That was the love of my life, that working with this man
uh-huh.
who was
what did you
the
learn
most
from
beautiful performer
what
in the world.
What did you learn from him?
Every night I would watch him and I'd learn something else.
I mean, he had magic, didn't he?
He had magic and he could do everything well. He was just, he was the best performer ever to be.
Shecky Green, come on.
I loved Shecky.
Another comic.
I was working a lot at the Riviera,
uh-huh.
and I worked with Joan Rivers, I worked with Toadie Fields, and then they asked if I'd come in with Shecky Green, who I thought was a genius. He was like a Lou Costello to me. I mean,
he was a great inventor on stage. He invented.
And could sing, and knew music,
uh-huh.
and the best timing,
uh-huh.
and he was always quick.
You've worked with some great comedians.
Some great people.
Some great comedians.
Bill Cosby I worked
Bill Cosby.
With. And
but Toadie Fields, come on.
Toadie was wonderful.
She
I loved her so much. Yeah, she was great. And I love Joan Rivers. She was wonderful, wonderful. This is the early
why
early
is Joan,
stages.
Why is Joan having not a tough time to get on late TV?
I think it'll happen for her.
I want it to happen.
She's,
I think
the
she's
the best at what she does.
For me.
And I'm sure it will happen. Yeah,
for
just
her.
A matter of time. Absolutely. Oh,
she should
nobody
be on
like
the late
her.
Hour. Why?
I adore her. I want to do her show again. I just love talking with her. She's just...
Uh-huh.
Can we talk, Frank? Can we talk?
Yeah.
I mean, there's just no one like her. I adore her.
Uh-huh.
But I've had some great, even the time when I met Dick Haymes and singing with him. I mean,
uh-huh.
And we always were friends. We remain friends, which is always wonderful to
you
say.
You have remained friends?
Oh.
Always.
Well, he passed away,
yes,
you know,
yeah,
a long time
but
ago.
But you always remained
but we
friends
always
when
remain
he was alive.
Friends.
Always.
Yeah. And I liked a lot of his ex-wives. You know, Jo Andrew was wonderful.
She's great.
She's a great lady. Nora Eddington, who came in the restaurant last year,
yep.
a great gal.
Yep.
And Haymes always said, I like you ladies because you're like buddies. You're like real broads. And I go, that's a nice way to put it.
Broads.
You're friends, yeah.
Uh-huh. That's good, yeah.
Yeah.
Are you writing a book, Fran Jeffries?
You know, everybody thinks I should.
Why not? Everyone else's?
I know. Everyone
you were
else.
Married to Dick Haymes.
I was married to Dick Haymes and
you
Richard
were married.
Quine,
you...
the director.
Hey.
I know.
Richard Quine.
Richard Quine.
Come on. There's a guy who's a great director.
So actually, I'm thinking about... Yes, maybe it's time to write a book. Of course, my life is still so full and so much is happening, Skippy, so that people say, well, wait just a little longer. You know, maybe there's more to put in this book yet. Let's wait another 5 or 6, 7
Shelley
years.
Shelley Winters is right through three of them already.
Oh, well, she had
a
crazy life since she was 10 or 12 or 15.
So.
She's
You've...
wonderful. I love her. But maybe I will.
Here's a girl comes from San Jose.
San Jose, bean
Come
picker.
Come on. Being meeting Picker, a big man from Hollywood.
I think in 5 years I might. What would you like to hear? What would be a great title for this book?
That's, I don't know. That's I what I'm I really thinking. It'll come. The only way to do the book is to talk on the tape recorder, Fran.
I know.
And just go back into your life.
So you've given me a great...
Is it because you don't want to hear it? Is that it, you think?
No. I love talking about that. I love talking about... Because I don't know if I'd do the same thing over again, as you always ask. Would
yes,
you do the
I
same?
Do. Right.
I don't know if I would.
Uh-huh.
Some of the things maybe so. But, no, I love to talk about that, the past, and bring up these wonderful people that I worked with. And I think it should be in a book. And I think in about... 5 years. Give me 5 years when my grandchildren are a little older so they won't be so, you know, inquisitive about, well, what really happened? You uh-huh. know, let them get a little older uh-huh. before I write
You're very
this
close
book.
With your daughter, though.
Very You're much very, so, so, yeah. We're yes. we're best friends now. You know, it's like...
Best friends.
When you're growing up teenagers and I was on uh-huh. the road and it was difficult because she always thought I was leaving her. Why uh-huh. was I leaving her? And uh-huh. I was out there making a living and doing something that uh-huh. I love doing. But she understands now that she has her two children, her daughters, and she has a business. She's a businesswoman.
She was at Le Dôme restaurant for a long time.
For a long time, many years. She managed that restaurant.
Yeah, she managed Le Dôme, one of the best restaurants in this town.
She's a good businesswoman.
And now but you must have a lot of celebs come to your place.
Oh, they're all there. They're all there.
Who's some of the celebs?
Jackie Collins is there a lot.
Is she really?
And a wonderful moment, I think, two, three months ago, Roddy McDowell, who loves Stephanie, comes in a lot for lunch.
I love
Stephanie. She said, I'm bringing Shirley MacLaine and Elizabeth Taylor.
Uh-huh.
And that's the only time I said, really? Then I'm staying. I'm not leaving after uh-huh. the lunch, because they came in quite about 2:30, 2:45, and stayed till uh-huh. 5. Uh-huh. And I just, because I love Roddy McDowell.
Do you do any acting now, Fran?
I haven't done acting, Skippy, in a long time. I mean, it was like, I did a few of the comedy things. I did Harem Scarem. I never concentrated, never focused on that area that much.
Why not now?
Well, what am I going to play? The grandmother?
No, not at all. You're an actress. You can play everything.
I don't know.
You know?
I don't know.
You enjoy singing. You enjoy singing.
I love music and I love singing. And I'm really concentrating on, as I showed you, I've uh-huh. got 4 or 5 tunes.
You have a new album now.
We're going to put that in a new album.
Yeah, what is this, Fran?
It's going to be Fran Jeffries called Seasoned. The album is going to be Seasoned.
I like that.
Isn't that a nice name?
Yes. Yeah.
And all just wonderful songs that maybe 2 or 3 originals. And just great ballads that maybe things that I did when I was 20 or 21 that I really didn't have the depth to sing those things, those songs. Now I pick everything that I know I mean, you know, I've lived.
We used to have a room in Beverly Hills called the...
Ye Little Club?
Ye Little Club, Marsha Wetson.
I worked there a lot.
I know you did. Mm-hmm. And we don't have that type of little room anymore.
Well...
Someone should open a little room where...
Not really, except there is a place that I like that I'm going to be working also. It's a little jazz club called La Café.
La Café.
La Café in Sherman Oaks, and it's on Ventura, and it's wonderful. A lot of recording people. It's excellent. And you go, there's maybe 75, 80 people.
Uh-huh.
You go to listen. And it's really for people that have just a record out.
Record.
And you want to go and
go
listen.
Listen to them.
It's not a big stage. It's not a performing kind of
room. Uh-huh. Berlinghi, All My Children. Oh, come on. The hottest hunk on the show in New York. Why did you leave it? Let's first of all, why did you leave that show?
Honest to God, just because I wanted to come back to California. I felt.
Is that what it was?
Yeah, you know, I grew up here.
I know you did.
I've known you for a long time, you know.
Is that the only reason you left, because you had enough of New York for a while, or what?
That was one of the big reasons, you know. My life was ready for another change again.
And
I felt really that I'd done at that time really all I could do with the show, you know.
Matt, let's go back. Matt Berlinghi, here we are sitting at the Beverly Hills High School. Come on, Matt.
My alma mater.
How does this feel? Matt, I'm interviewing you here at the Beverly Hills High. Is this where you went to school?
Yeah, and to walk down the hall was, you know, to the door, right. I still got lost, but.
Did you really?
Yeah, I got lost, but. Looking around, I remembered exactly where I was when I looked down the hall and saw that the patio outside to the right, and then knowing that I used to have lunch out there all the time, and then the library up around on the other side. I mean,
was it fun growing up here in Beverly Hills? Coming to this school, especially.
It had its ups and downs. I mean, I'm not an angel. I mean, I got into trouble.
When they say this really 9006, is it, or what?
902, get out of here, really.
Is that what this is called? When they see that in Orange County or in Missouri, is it really like that when you were growing up here?
No, and that's been really frustrating. I mean, I've always said that all these kids that are, and they're not really kids, are they, involved
in
that show, I'll always wish him success as long as it runs, you know, just like I did for all the people with Charlie's Angels and Fantasy Island, if you get what I'm saying, you know.
Right.
It's gonna pass.
Right.
The most frustrating thing about it has been that while it's great that the success has been there for them and a lot of people are interested, a lot of people are getting a really warped version of what it's like. I mean, that's why it's just to watch. Just the opening of the show, just to see. I mean, it's not Beverly High.
It's not High. Beverly High.
No,
is it?
And if they called it Akron, Ohio 06122 or whatever, you know, no one would watch it. It's because of the Beverly Hills mystique, which really, I mean, I don't like that. For me, having gone to school here, and always having heard that, ooh, Beverly Hills.
Yes,
I mean, I never saw what was so great about it. I mean, now I'm old enough to really appreciate some of the things, you know. I was lucky that my parents didn't spoil me rotten, you know, like a lot of people. I mean,
Matt, you're sitting
I never
there.
Went for wanting, you know, granted. Uh-huh. I never went for wanting real, you know, if I needed something. I always had a good pair of shoes on my feet, but I mean.
Mother's Italian.
Oh, yeah.
She's an Italian countess.
Yeah.
A real Italian countess. And that makes you
a count.
A count.
Yeah.
But you don't use that title. You don't, it's no reason for you to use it. Is that it?
I'm just a guy.
Just a guy.
I'm Matt.
Matt Berlinghi, when you decided to become an actor, at what age? I mean, you knew when you were going to school.
I knew
You're
when
walking
I was
down
seven.
The halls.
I knew when I was seven. It was way before Beverly that I knew.
Really?
I mean, it was elementary school at Hawthorne, you know, another Beverly Hills school.
Right.
Seven, eight, nine, I'd be walking along the sidewalk thinking, where's the camera? What's going on?
Really?
I mean, I was silly. It was like I had such a romanticized idea of what acting was about. I mean, I had that crazy thought that if I was standing at the stop sign pretending I was in a movie, that some guy in a limo was going to pull up and say, you're the kid for the next feature. I mean, but that's part of growing up.
Studied? You'd never studied?
Oh, no, I studied.
Did you study?
I studied plenty.
No, before you went to movies? Did you study before that?
Sure.
Oh, did you really?
I started here in the theater classes.
At the Beverly Hills?
Under an old coach that used to be here. He's not anymore. He left the year after I left. His name was John Engel.
Okay.
And he was really, really nice guy.
Uh-huh.
I was, 15, 14 when I started here.
Uh-huh.
As a sophomore, I went to private school for freshman year, but here and then other places like the Strasberg Institute and Tracy Roberts.
You did some extra work for it. You wanted to do some extra work to see the other side.
I did a lot of extra work.
You wanted to see the other side of it.
I just wanted to see everything of it. You know, I wanted to see what a C-stand was, you know, and now I know what a C-stand is. Uh-huh. And there's no, if you're going to be in this business, I think the best thing you can do is build as many little, you know, steps on the ladder for yourself, uh-huh. because uh-huh. no one's going to come pulling you up
right.
without.
Now, you did a film. It was called The American...
Nightmare. Scream. It was
Scream.
The American
Nightmare
Scream.
But it was Nightmare Scream. It was a nightmare.
It was a nightmare called The American Scream.
Yeah.
And, you know...
That was your first feature film.
That was my first feature. And it was really... it taught me a lot about work. I mean, I thought that the pressure on all my children was heavy, but here I was shooting 20-hour days on the American Scream,
right.
because it was maybe 2-3 weeks of principal photography, real
right.
fast, low budget, and literally making sure I learned my lines
right.
between little catnaps on the set.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So I can't say that I was really prepared for it,
uh-huh.
but it was a good experience.
But then you did some TV starring on some guest shows. Mm-hmm. Like, you've done a lot of, name some shows for me you've done.
Episodics.
Like, you've done Hunter.
Hunter done, was the
tell
final
me about
one.
The final thing on Hunter.
That was it was a minute scene with Fred Dreyer.
And that's where all my children saw
yeah.
Matt Berlinghi.
That was it.
Come on, Matt. They saw you and they said, hey, we want that guy.
The morning after it aired, you know, the uh-huh. morning after it aired, I got the phone call.
They knew. And they screened you, they had you flew to New York.
Well, there was a little process where first I had to meet the head lady out here, and then they screen tested me at the General Hospital set.
Okay.
And then they sent the tape to New York, flew me out there for another screen test,
uh-huh.
and that was on a Thursday. Friday in the airport at JFK waiting uh-huh. to come back. I checked my machine here in L.A.
Great.
And there was the word that I was starting work on Tuesday. So I came back here, got two duffel bags and a couple boxes, and I was living in New York Monday.
Matt Berlinghi got very excited.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Matt Berlinghi went right
through
the roof.
What were you thinking of when you were on the plane going to New York at the time? What was Matt Berlinghi thinking of going to...
I was thinking of trying to find an apartment in a week because they were willing to put me in a hotel for
uh-huh.
a week.
Uh-huh.
So Sunday I was checking the Yellow Pages looking for places to call on Monday.
Uh-huh.
Monday I found a place, had an apartment already before my first day of work Tuesday. And also, I mean, I can't say I was really had a million things rushing through my head besides just basically relocating.
Right.
Because it all happened so fast that I never really had a chance to sit there and say, okay, the reality of what's happening right now is I'm about to be on TV every day.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
You know, I never really took time. And by the time that started kicking in, I was already on TV every day, and it was just a regular thing. I mean, my ex-girlfriend and I
uh-huh.
would be walking through the streets, and someone would say something, and we'd look at each other and say, oh, yeah, that's right, I'm on All My Children. Wow, I'm on All My Children.
Was that exciting for you, wasn't
it?
It was
something.
It's not just exciting, but that's work there. You had to get
it's
up. What time of the day?
Work.
It's hard.
I woke up on an average of 6:30.
So, scripts constantly being changed.
Yeah, you get your changes when you get there in the morning.
It's hard work, Matt.
Exhausting.
I mean, from 6, say, you're up there 6 till what time? Late at night?
Well, generally it was 12-13-hour days. You know, there were times when
So you're saying the movie was that Scream? The Scream was harder than that, Matt?
Well, because I knew it was just short term. You know, with All My Children, I mean, it's an ongoing storyline that takes its curves and twists.
Right.
You get to know the character, you know, and I got to know, and I felt comfortable about giving Brian Bodine a little
Brian
bit of Matt Berlinghi.
What a strong name. Soaps
always have those names. I mean, Brian Bodine, Trask Bodine, older brother, you know.
But Brian Bodine became a big star, hunk star, overnight, though.
Yeah,
look at the fan mail. You must get a lot of fan mail, did you?
Yeah.
A lot of them.
I was very fortunate, you know. A lot of people tuned into what I was about, and really,
what
really
is Matt Berlinghi really about? Come on, I know you're not just you know, you're a nice young man from Beverly Hills who wanted to be an actor. But there's more than just because you left that soap, you want to come back. There's a little more seriousness about Matt Berlinghi.
Well, I started at times as exhausted as I was by the work of All My Children, and as much as I wanted to dive into it more,
right.
and I'm curious to know what would have happened, you uh-huh. know, if I'd stayed there. But at the same time,
You have no regrets by leaving?
I miss it sometimes. I miss the people. You know, when I see the people on a talk show or something, I watch. You know, because I want to. You know, and going back for awards ceremonies, I get to see everyone.
Right. Matter of fact, you just got an award.
Yeah.
Come on.
A week after I moved back to town.
A week after you moved back.
Yeah, the same week.
Let's watch this award, okay?
Okay.
It must have been felt funny you got this award after you're back in town.
It was a little strange, but it really meant a lot because the soap opera award is voted by the fans, you know. So
the fans vote this.
Yeah. The editors in the magazine, you know, they pick who they think should be voted on, and then the fans narrow it down from a field of 11 to a field of 3.
Okay, let's my audience see who won
let's
this.
See.
Okay,
I don't even know myself.
Okay?
Okay,
I do know, but I'm going to tell them. Okay, let's do it.
The nominees for Outstanding Younger Leading Actor and Actress all played the game of love.
However, only some of them got to pass go.
Many a tear has to fall. All in the wonderful game.
You have words with him, and your future's looking dim, but these things.
There's nothing wrong with me.
Rise above.
Oh, once in a while he won't come. In the game.
And the nominees for Outstanding Younger Leading Actor are...
All My Children's Brian, The Teenage Romeo with Three Juliets, Matt Borlenghi. From As the World Turns, Holden. Holden's getting an award? Wait a minute. Holden, who had brain surgery and forgot that he was married to a mob, John Hensley. And from The Young and the Restless, Ryan, the cocky conniver who burned his candle at both ends, Scott Reeves.
And the winner is... Outstanding Younger Leading Actor is Matt Borlenghi, All My Children.
Thank you very much. A lot of people know already that I decided to go on to whatever else there is out there and try other things. There are people I'd like to thank, like Agnes Nixon and Felicia Monet Bear and the family at All My Children that welcomed me into their arms. And, oh, you know, my mom, my dad, my family, all that. And. This is great. Soap Opera Digest Magazine, thank you very much. Have a good night.
Matt, that's great. How did you feel holding that? I know there was a tearful thing there just a moment. You felt, couldn't talk anymore.
Yeah.
You made your mother very happy. That was your mommy hugging you?
That was my mom that hugged me.
Hugged you?
Yeah. I wanted just once before I was really out of that world.
Uh-huh.
I wanted her to see what I'd been involved with and meet some of the people, you know, David Canary, who you
right.
know, so give me a hug also.
They're all going to miss you.
I miss them.
And you're going to miss them.
Yeah.
But do you think you might go back? Because they're asking, they want Brian Dean to come back.
Yeah.
Understand the people here in Hollywood or all my General Hospital, all of them are after you.
Found out about that, huh?
Yeah, I found out they're all after you, Matt.
Right now.
Because the fan mail is so.
Yeah, I mean, I really like.
You got
like
fans
I was
out
saying,
there.